I think this is probably my sixth or seventh CakeFest. I've been coming to this event since the very beginning, back way back 2008 in Orlando. I think the only survivors from that time are two people, Larry and myself. Am I correct? Yeah, right? Yeah. So the one thing that I like about this, well, I like several things about this event, but the thing that I like the most is how diverse and how inclusive the community in cake is. Particularly for me, which I haven't been using cake for a very long time. And so this is a talk that I actually wanted to give for a long time. Well, not for a long time, but for a couple of years, but I think this is the perfect moment to give it. And we're gonna go through why that's the perfect moment. So the first thing we're gonna get out of the way is who's in the audience who has been working with machine learning algorithms of the next lady. You? Cool, you wanna join? Awesome. So for most of us who haven't worked before with machine learning, we think of these complex things and algorithms and techniques to deal with very life-threatening things like, you know, healthcare and stuff. So this is RoboCop. This is a very interesting event that happens every year. It started in 1997, and every year they do sort of different types of competitions within the event, the main event being when people don't get to choose the robot, they get to choose the software. So that's the important part, and that's the cool part. And the main objective of this event is actually quite something very, 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 I would say, crazy. They fear that by 2050, they're gonna assemble a team of robots that is going to play against the last World Cup champion, and is going to win against the last World Cup champion. That seems kind of crazy considering the caliber of players that Argentina, I mean, the world produces. So it is kind of crazy, right? Like, who can beat Messi right now? But if you think about that 40 years from now, if you go back 40 years, who has been alive for more than 40 years? I'm so glad that I don't get to raise my hand. Up until next year. Next year I will have to raise my hand. So 40 years ago, actually I think 2 days ago, about 4 years ago, April 2 was launched. The very first time that April 2 was launched. Also 40 years ago, the Atari 2600 was launched. It was the first gaming console to include card writers with ROM chips. So that was pretty advanced back then. If you look at it now, it's not that advanced. Also in 1977, 40 years ago, Star Wars, the first edition of Star Wars was launched. I think that's great. But the most important thing that happened 40 years ago was that my parents were conceiving me. So that's great. So I know that when we think about machine learning and we think about these complex things and robots and whatever, we think that doesn't apply to, you hear a little bit of noise when I talk. No, I'm fine, okay, cool. So I know that when we discuss these things that seem very complex, they don't seem to apply to our day-to-day jobs. When we are dealing with, I don't know, a ticket that says, can you make this title more bluish, or can you move these 2 pixels to the left, that's very far from machine learning in our understanding. But the truth is that lately, we all developers had to move away from our comfort zone. We stopped being pure developers and we started being system administrators. We started learning about database optimization. We started learning about distributed networking systems, all this stuff that wasn't on our menu before that is there now. So I think it's our responsibility as developers to start learning these techniques. And today's talk, if there's one thing that I want you to get out of this talk, is that these techniques that we're gonna go through is actually applicable to everyone's job. And you can do that right now. So it is our responsibility to actually start getting involved with these things. So, and the crazy thing is that MIT made a study and stated that more than 80% of major companies are using machine learning right now at some point or at some area in their business. The crazy thing is that 10 years ago, that was very hard to find. It was very hard to find a single company that would use machine learning before. Because machine learning actually is not something very new. The concepts that are behind machine learning go way back. In 1950, who knows about the Turing test? Turing test is something that Alan Turing developed to test how intelligent a machine can be or not. Then in 1952, we had the first chess program, the first chess software that would learn and try to play against a human. In 1990, some person, which I can't remember the name, moved from the concept of knowledge learning, which was the way machine learning was done before. Knowledge learning meaning I have to sort of already tell the machine what they're learning in order for it to learn. We moved from that concept into data learning, which is what we're going to see today. That was 1980. It's not that long ago. 1997, Deep Blue beats Kasparov, and the whole world changed. 2006, this is, again, only 11 years ago, we started learning about deep learning, a concept that we're going to discuss very heavily today, which gives us the possibility to do pattern recognition on images, which is really, really cool. And 2010, Skynet, Microsoft introduced Skynet. Introduced that would recognize gestures and human features and all that. That was 2010, 6 years ago. 2010 was 2 years later than the first CakeFest. So, you know, things are moving very, very rapidly. So what changed? What made all this development actually concentrate in the last 5 to 10 years? The first thing that changed is chip storage. We started having all these applications that would store all this information, and before, 10 years ago, storing information was expensive. So we were thinking about bytes versus kilobytes versus megabytes. Now storage is very, very cheap. Well, I deal with some companies that don't consider that, and they kind of are stingy with storage, but for the most part, storage is very cheap. So that gives us the possibility to start storing everything that we want from our users. When they log in, when they click, whatever they do, we're starting to store it, even without knowing precisely what we would do with that data. So okay, that's great. We have all this data that before, 30 years ago, producing the amount of data that we produce now in 30 days would have taken decades. Right now, it's only a matter of just storing whatever I want to store it. And to realize or to actually take advantage of this concept of storing, we sort of need to realize that we need to know domain knowledge, knowing what is important for my application to store. If I'm doing a real estate application, should I store, what kind of properties that the user look at, what are they interested in, when they search, what sort of filters they apply, so I can start learning from that. The other thing that changed was computing power. Again, 5 years ago, 10 years ago, even if I had the ability to store these petabytes of information, processing that amount of information would have taken a lot of time or a lot of money. Right now, that's almost a non-problem. The previous talk, it was very impressive to learn that $400 would get you like 10 million, I can't remember how many million views, but that's how cheap processing power is right now. So there's no point for us not to take advantage of these possibilities. And also, in the last, I think, year, no more than 2 years, in the last year and year and a half, all the cloud services, the major cloud services, started introducing machine learning specific solutions, which we are going to review today. So great, we have all this stuff. So we have computing power, we have the ability to store data. What do we do with that? We apply a little bit of science. I love this statement. I always go back to that. A little bit of science. So we're going to see today, don't worry, I'm not going to bore you with mathematics or anything, but most of the concepts that machine learning relies on are borrowed from mathematics and from biology, crazy enough. So we're going to apply a little bit of science to stop guessing. This is, I don't know how many of you work in companies or projects where every now and then you get someone saying, can we just change the way the sign-up form works because I don't think this is effective, so I think we should move this field to or hide this thing because I think that this is going to produce more revenue or less, to decrease churn rate. We do a lot of assumptions. In every single company, at least that I worked, I've always had someone saying that their intuition told them that this is what we should do. And the reality is that that's a very bad way to conduct businesses. We need to start learning from data and rely less on human beings, because human beings suck. So we need to start getting data. I'm going to start with a typical example, but for me, that's actually very, very, it's very practical to my day-to-day business. There's a project that I've been working on for the last 2 years. I have some of my coworkers here. I work with them, they bear me. They have to put up with me, but some of them are here. And the most basic example that machine learning that allows us to introduce ourselves to machine learning is house pricing. In our project, we work with investors, you know, real estate investors, that they would purchase a house, put some money on top of it, increase the bathrooms and whatever, and resell the house and make a profit out of it. So for us, for our project, it's very important that we start at the very basic knowledge, which is what is the, how much money can I get out of a property that I buy? This is about, I think, 50,000 or, yeah, I can't remember how many properties. Yeah, 5,000 active properties in the last 3 months in the Utah, in Utah. And we can see a little bit of, well, since it's 5,000, we see a lot of properties right here, but we start seeing a little bit of a correlation between how big the house is and how expensive or cheap the house is, is active or listed on the market. So if I wanted to, because this is my business, I need to tell my investors for how much money they can actually sell the house. If I wanted to predict a house price here, I would visually sort of guess. I would take, I don't know, if it's a 3,000 square feet, well, it's probably around here, right? If it's, I don't know, 7,500, it's probably around here, and it's probably around here. Naturally, that's not what we do. It's not that someone calls us and we go to the graphing and look at the probable price. We start to get to guess prices out of some parameters or some sort of way of identifying what is the correlation between the area and the pricing. Normally, if I wanted to simplify this, I would say, okay, maybe there's a line, maybe there's a visual way to predict the price based on the square footage, right? So a line is very simple to predict, but what happens if maybe that's not what I want? Maybe the correlation is not linear, but it's quadratic, cubic, or some higher order function. This is something that normally we wouldn't have to deal with. We wouldn't have to deal with figuring out what sort of function I can correlate my living area with my listing price. In this case, I'm doing, I think it's a sixth order. I can't remember what order this function is. But you can see how the function is trying to adapt to a highest price. So it's very dangerous sometimes for us to actually deal with this and try to figure ourselves. We need a little bit of machine for us to figure it out. So let's start by making the simplest, most basic assumption that the correlation is linear. So that means, you know, there's a linear way of identifying from one living area to the price that somehow is defined by a sort of parameter that would change the degree or the angle of the line, how big it is, or an position or bias that would change where does the line start. Because obviously a 10 square feet price, a 10 square feet house is not gonna go for $10 or something like that. So this is a way for me to define what sort of linear or identify a way to actually identify what the house price is based on the living area. So let's try to figure this out. How do I know if the line that I find is actually the best line that I could find, the best fit? How would I know if, you know, the line, if it's this way or that way or that way? We start seeing what sort of error, what sort of distance is between the predicted price, which is the price that the line tells me, versus the actual price. So this is actually the distance between, you know, my line and the actual price that I see. The line that actually fits to decrease the distance for the most properties is the line that I want to use in my system. So I need to sort of find a way not to just hang on to one value and say, okay, if I decrease this error, then I'm fine. No, I need to take into account all the properties. So I sort of need to balance out all the errors. I go through all the values of the prediction versus the real prices. I sum them up. I put squares so I don't balance out. So prices that go below the line don't actually balance out my error. I sum out all those together, and I call this an error or a cost function. So if I find a line where the error or the cost is as minimal as possible, then that's the line that I'm going to stick with. So that seems pretty simple, right? It seems that we're just doing basic mathematics, doing a linear exercise where we find a linear correlation between our price, our living area, and our price. we're going to use a tool that was actually released only in November 2015, which is called TensorFlow. Anyone who has worked with machine learning in the last year probably is using TensorFlow. TensorFlow was released by Google. I wonder when we are going to start saying was released by Alphabet instead of Google, but well, was released by Google in November 2015 and allows us, it's open source, and allows us to do these and more complex calculations. So we're going to start using TensorFlow to find that visual correlation between my living area and my house prices. The first thing that I need to do, and this is, I'm going to go through this prepare and other statements very often because this is a very basic framework for machine learning. The first thing that we need to do is gather the data, which in my case was all the 5,000 properties in Utah, put them some way where I can actually use them from the code, from my code, and you know, just fit it to the code. TensorFlow is Python. I know it's not PHP, but Python is actually the best tool for this job. There's a PHP project that was launched, I think, less than a year ago, which is GitHub. I can't remember the owner. Oh, yeah, github.com/php-ml for machine learning. I haven't tested that project. I've seen the code. It's actually quite promising. But in my opinion, I will always stick with TensorFlow because of the amount of community work that is behind this tool and the actual complex stuff that we can do with it. So my first problem when dealing with TensorFlow is first, like we said, preparing the data and fitting it. There's no need for you to figure this out. What I'm doing simply here is just taking a CSV file of prices and house sizes and just putting it in an array. But the number one problem that I will have and that you will have the first time that you try to do something with TensorFlow is that it is very important to figure out just how big of a scale of values I have. If I wanted to actually run TensorFlow predictions with this data, it wouldn't work. It would immediately fail and I wouldn't get any values because the distance between this value, this property, which I really want to know what it is because, oh my God, $10 million, and this property, there are so many values in between that for TensorFlow to figure out a way to find the line would be very hard because what TensorFlow does is actually it goes back to this formula that I will define in code, we'll see shortly, and starts testing values, modifying W, modifying B, trying to find the values that minimize my cost. So since it goes one step at a time, it's very hard for me to do that if the values are large. If the values are large, incrementing the values of the lines would take a long time for me to get to this property. So the first thing that we do is try to scale down the graphic, which is used by a method in mathematics that you can look up. It's very, very simple to follow, but it's called the standard score, which is dividing by the mean and subtracting the mean and dividing by the standard deviation to make the graphic go way smaller. Less values, less higher values, but the same distribution of data. So I don't have a problem with, you know, modifying my data in any way. So the first thing that I do in TensorFlow, like we said, is we prepare the data, we import it, we process it to put down the values so we can actually start learning from it. The second thing is choosing the model. Again, this is these three steps that I'm going to discuss are applicable to every single concept in TensorFlow. Choosing the data, second step is choosing the model. In my case, the model is I want to perform linear regression. I sort of figure that my data is linear, so I know that I want to actually infer values using a linear regression with a linear function. So the second thing, like we said, is choosing the model. We choose a linear regression. This formula right here. And that's the way I write in TensorFlow. So it's very down to earth. It's nothing complicated. In TensorFlow, the first thing that we sort of learn is how it works. The way it works is, like we said, is we start testing values for W and B try to minimize the cost. So we obviously have some sort of way to fit it actual data, you know, my actual living area versus my actual living prices, and then we'll sort of need a way to tell it, okay, these are the two things in my formula that I need you to figure out. We want TensorFlow to tell me what are the best values for W and B that would actually find the best correlation for my house versus living areas. So this is very simple. This is my model. These are my values that I will feed when we start feeding values so we can find the values. And these are the two variables that we want TensorFlow to train on, to learn on. The cost function, this is a way for us, again, TensorFlow knows now what model I want, but it doesn't know how to figure out if the model that I want, how to figure out the best fit for that model. It needs a cost function. It's a way for me to tell it, this is the way for you to figure out whenever you find whatever value for WMB, this is a way for you to figure out if it's too costly or actually it's better than whatever other value you tested before. My cost function here is actually, it looks a little bit different, but it's exactly the same thing I had before. It's the sum of all of the difference between my predicted price and my actual price to the square. This is a little bit, normally when you see linear regression in TensorFlow, it's either this for this example in particular in house pricing, or applying a sort of modification to actually minimize the error as we go along. And the other thing is, once I define my variables, once I define the data that I will provide for TensorFlow to figure out, once I define my model and my cost function, it's actually saying, okay, how do we want TensorFlow to figure out or to start testing values? And this is the most important, probably most important decision that you make when you do linear regression with TensorFlow, which is deciding what sort of way for TensorFlow to get to those values. So if you think that TensorFlow goes through values of W and B incrementally trying to find the best values, it will take a little bit of time. So how does TensorFlow decide how fast or how slow to increment possible values for W? How would they decide how fast or how slow to increase or decrease the value of B until it finds the best fit for my line? And this is my way of saying it. I want you to learn at a rate of 0.01. The higher the learning rate, the faster I might get to the best fit, but the most possible I would miss that best fit because I will start incrementing in bigger values. W would move, I don't know, from 0.3 to 0.5 in one test. I might miss that maybe the best solution is right in the middle. So I may decide to decrease the learning rate, but the lower the learning rate, the more time it would take. Gradient descent optimizer is the most typical example for linear regression, which is, again, you can Google it. I'm not going to go to the mathematics behind it, but it's a very simple way for TensorFlow to start trying different values, and when it finds something that it didn't work, it goes back and it starts testing another value. It's sort of what we do when we are trying to get from the top of a hill to the bottom, trying to find the shortest path. If you had a lot of time in your life, you would just go through down a step and try to see if it was the shortest possible way from that section to the next section of the mountain. And if it didn't, you go back up, and then you move to another path and you go down. Obviously, that's not practical, but for machines, that's perfect. That's gradient descent. So by simply doing this, I define the whole thing. I define what sort of data I will provide, how I will provide it, what sort of linear regression model I want to follow, how is TensorFlow going to find if it's the best or the worst fit, and what sort of way or technique does TensorFlow use to actually decrease or increase the values until it finds a solution. So I have all the model defined, I prepare my data, the next thing that I need to do is actually, okay, now that I have the model defined and the data prepared, I will start feeding this data to TensorFlow so it can figure it out. This is the training part, where I get my property data and I feed it to TensorFlow a lot of times until it figures out, okay, this is my best value. This is a very simple process where I iterate over a specific number of times, which I define. I can play with this a lot, and I go through every single item in my CSV, every pair of living area versus price, and I feed it to TensorFlow, let it run 1,000 times until it tells me, okay, up until this point, this is the best value that I could find for W and B. This is what I'm doing here. Right here, I'm printing out all the steps, and I will see how it decreases. It keeps decreasing the cost, which is my main objective, decreasing the cost until I find out a best value. So one thing to figure out is, one thing that we may, when we start working with TensorFlow, is, okay, there are so many variables here, like 0.01, that I don't know what to do. There's 1,000 steps. I don't know if 100 steps is better, if 1,000 steps is better, if 10,000 steps is better. There is a way even to actually make TensorFlow learn the best steps, the best learning rate. We can actually make this way more complex and let TensorFlow figure out the best number of iterations until we get to the best value. So when I apply to my example, I may find a line that may not look like what I visually would have expected, but it's what TensorFlow found. This is the line that TensorFlow tells me this is the best fit for the data, at least until you let me work, or as many steps that you let me work. This obviously, since as I said before, we modify the data to make the values between zero and the highest value as low as possible. So in this graphic, obviously the scale looks different than my property prices. Obviously, I'm not going to get a property for $2. So, but this is my modified values. So this is great. It looks like I've done it. I found a linear correlation. I found the best fit, or TensorFlow found the best fit for me, and that's all I need to do. Well, the first problem that we have in our example is if I train on all my properties, I may have a biased solution, because I've seen 5,000 properties where the distribution of data looked like this, but maybe next month there's, I don't know, a set of new active properties, 100 properties that would be located completely different. What if next month my properties for, 1,000 square feet would look, or would be positioned in a completely different place? Then my model, the model that I found, is not applicable. Doesn't work, it sucks. So we sort of need a way to actually say, okay, now that I've trained my data, how do I test, or how do I predict that this is going to be a good fit for new data coming in? I sort of need a way to divide. What if I did the following? What if I took all the property, all the 5,000 properties, and divided into two different sets? I would divide 30% of the data would go to one set, and then 70% of the data would go to another set. I would train on the 70%, and then I would test the train, the actual values that TensorFlow found, against the testing data. If I do that, then I can see if the cost, the training cost, would actually be higher or lower than the cost when I run my model against actual data, which is my testing data. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to take this, the 5,000 properties, and divide it into two sets, my testing set and my training set. This seems kind of boring, but you'll see that this is actually the backbone of even more complex problems, as we're going to see later on, such as neural networks. So this is something very important to consider. Not only I need to prepare my data, not only I need to choose a model, and not only I need to figure out a way to actually analyze the cost and decrease that cost, I also need to find a way to test and train. Train first, and then test whatever values I found. Again, this is not for you to figure out, but this is very simple. I just divided the steps. This is the first, the same code as before, where I train, iterating over training, and then once I found whatever I found, I will run that against my training data. So it's the same code. I'll publish these slides later so you can check the code. That's not the point of this talk. The point is understanding the three steps. So when I run this in TensorFlow, I start seeing how it works. This is 1,000, again, if you see, if you remember, we did 1,000 iterations. So TensorFlow starts testing values, possible values for W and B, keeps testing it and tells me the cost. And the whole objective is to decrease the cost as much as possible. Maybe this doesn't mean much to us. 0.34 cost doesn't mean much to us. But when we analyze and we run this model against my testing cost, and I see that even my testing cost could be lower than the training cost, it means that I may be on the right track. I don't see this cost being highly or much higher when I tested it. I actually see that it worked pretty well. It didn't suck that much. Normally, what we would do for us to understand how successful, how failure this model with this set of values is I divide these two. I divide this with this, and that's the analysis, or that's the actual total cost of my model. The difference between the cost that it took me to train this model and cost that it took me to actually test this model. So this is great. What happens if instead of, a linear correlation between living price and I'm sorry, living area and my price? Again, like we said before, we have a higher order function, a quadratic, cubic, whatever, I don't care. if you remember when we did linear regression, it was a very simple formula. Well, I'm not going to go back too many slides. It was a very simple formula. It was y equals mx plus b. Here, I will have different values for different degrees of exponential. I will have one for x squared, one for x cubed, and so on and so forth. And I will have different ways or different parameters that will modify how much of an impact this particular degree has on the whole function. So I define my model very similarly to that what I did before, but instead of simply writing it, y equal x plus mx plus b, I would define it as a quadratic or cubic function. In my case, what I did here is actually something that I wanted to test. I said, okay, I'm going to grab a set of values here that I produce. This is my preparing of the data where I just make it up. I will create a function here. This is a very simple way of Python. I would love for PHP to have something like this. A very simple way for me to define a set of values. I create a list here of values where I just made up, okay, this is going to be my formula, this is going to be my real data, 2 times y, 2 times I, my plus I to the square, plus 0.5 to I to the cube. So this is my set of data, right? And then I want to find what's the best correlation. But I sort of know, because I produced the data, that this is nonlinear. It may be quadratic, it may be cubic or whatever. So what I'm doing here is I'm creating a function that would take whatever exponential or order of the function that I want, and I would create, you know, test the data, training until it finds the cost. It will create the model for me. So I will call this function first for degree 1, degree 2, degree 3, and then analyze the total cost for my function and see which one fits best. If I do that to a graph, if I put this in a graph, I will find actually something that makes sense, because I made my function to the cube, so it would be a cubic function. And what I see here is how TensorFlow, when it tried a linear function, a quadratic function, a cubic function, and then higher order, the one function that defines the lowest cost was obviously a cubic, because that's the data that I produced. So this is the main way for me to figure out what's the best order of a function that fits my data. Now, as we can all agree that figuring out the house price only based on living area doesn't make much sense. If I have a 3,000 square feet home with no bathroom, yeah, I'm going to pay a little bit less than one with bathrooms. So what do we do with that? How do we stop reading that? That's not the idea. I put this and I read it and it was super awesome. How do we deal with this data? We start seeing multiple dimensions. So instead of just having living area, what if I consider bathrooms? What if I consider bedrooms? What if I consider any other sort of characteristic that defines my property price? Then a linear regression model, even to the highest order function, sort of doesn't make sense, because I have more values to test on and more values to train on. So we start dealing with multiple dimensions. This is, for example, a way that just adding one more dimension to my problem would look like. Just adding not only living area, but number of bathrooms, then I start seeing a 3D graph. And what do I see here? Would I see a line? Obviously not. It's a plane. If I add a fourth dimension, then the problem is completely, for us humans, unsolvable, at least for me. So I don't see a line, I don't see a plane. When we go fourth dimension, five dimensions, we don't know how to figure it out. Fortunately, again, using the same technique that we did for linear regression for a very simple model, we can do the same for higher dimensions. We start by preparing the data, where I introduce now something a little bit more, a couple of dimensions. I start introducing, one more dimension, not only living area, but the lot size, how big the lot where the house resides in. And then, again, same thing as before, I do the prices, I try and I tell, okay, I have my data and my test data. Since I have both living area and lot area, I have two sets of data that I need to train and that I need to test. So I divide those. I divide those two sets of data. What's the model that I'm going to choose? Very similar to before, but again, since we introduce a second dimension, then my line is not, my model is not simply just one value that would vary and one value that would actually determine how much of an impact that value has on the property price. There is a second value now. which is lot size. So I introduce that second value to my model. And the rest keeps being the same, just, you know, bias here, property price, or prediction property price that I'm going to do. Again, this looks very similar to before, but the only thing is that I introduce a whole new set of data. So I introduce a new placeholder where I would feed the data, the actual data, and I introduce that variable in my model. That's it. That's all I have to do. The rest is exactly the same as before. I define the cost function, which is exactly the same. I try to minimize the error as much as possible, and I start telling it to, and I tell it to find that cost with a gradient descent optimization. There are a lot of other optimizers in TensorFlow. It's a very interesting exercise to learn them all, to test them all, but this is the most typical case. So I introduce my model again, the next thing that I do, and I train. I start training by giving exactly the same procedure, 1,000 steps, one step at a time. I feed the data, except that here I'm not only feeding living areas, I'm also feeding lots. This in Python is simply just iterating over each value in my list and feeding the data. Once it's done, it will find my best cost. And here I'm printing against one step at a time the different values in my model, W1 and W2 for the two different costs of data. I run my cost, I run my deduction, and I find the solution. In this case, again, there's no way that you will run the same code over and over and find the same result. It would be very hard for TensorFlow to produce the same result because, again, it's trying to figure out the value. So it's going to start with a value and then increment or decrement accordingly. So don't be surprised if when you run over and over, you find different costs. But it will give you an idea. It's not going to be something crazy. You won't find an iteration where you will find a cost as low as 0.3 and then in the next iteration, a cost as high as 10, for example. It will always sort of figure out the best cost, but not to a final. So this seems like fun, right? Not like doing this for every single use case in my company, kind of boring because I already, okay, there's a lot of code there. There's a lot of stuff that seems to be standard for almost every use case, in my case, for property pricing. So fortunately, there's a way for me to actually take advantage of people that have done that for us to simplify this whole process. I can't remember when it was launched, but it's pretty cool. This is Amazon Web Services. They launched a service where I can actually use my data, feed my data to Amazon, and it will predict the price, in my case, the price, or in your case, whatever other data you want to predict. In my case, for example, I just simply took the same CSV file that I ran on the examples, I uploaded to S3, I then just went to my area in Amazon where it's called Amazon Machine Learning, where I want to create a model. You see, the same thing. First, prepare the data, which in this case is uploading. Second is choosing my model. I go to Amazon, I create my model. I'm gonna go quickly through this, but I wanted to show the screens because it's actually the best way for us to actually start with this. I told it, okay, my data is on S3, I just uploaded it, so it's there. This is the path to my S3 file, my CSV, the one that I uploaded. I continue, I just put a name to my model, to my prediction. It takes the CSV and it tells me, okay, I see the CSV, I see the data, tell me please what sort of data I'm looking at. It will infer, actually, for the most part, it will infer the data type based on the data that I provided. So in my case, I uploaded a file with bedrooms, bathrooms, living area, lot size, and list price, way more dimensions than we were working before. And an ID for identifying whenever I want to debug or look at the logs of the model being run. So I upload, I define the structure, and I say, yeah, that looks good. Whatever you figure out, everything is numeric, so I don't have a problem with that. And I tell it, okay, this is the stuff that I want to predict. I've given you a CSV with actual values, but I want you to create a model where you will tell me the list price based on the other parameters, all the other variables that we want to base our prediction on. So we do that, we tell it, okay, the ID is an identifier, again, simply for login purposes, and we run it, and the next thing that we define is the model. We already uploaded the data, we already prepared the data, the next thing that we define is the model. For most use cases, just whatever Amazon sort of figures out is great. For our use cases, if you feel a little bit, you know, adventurous, then you can actually go in and define all the parameters, the cost function, everything that we did on TensorFlow before, how to optimize and everything. So I'm just gonna go with whatever Amazon tells me. I run it. It looks like okay, it's ready to create. I create it, and I can see how to actually test this. Once I upload it and create the model, it will give me a way for me to actually test this model in real life. So I go in, I give just random values, whatever I wanted to choose, and it tells me the predicted price based on my data. So this is way simpler than actually doing ourselves with TensorFlow. Now, if I wanted to do a service or if I wanted to actually make something useful out of this, obviously this is not very practical, me going with every single property and just entering manually. The other wouldn't be practical. The other awesome thing that Amazon does is provides an API endpoint for me to use this model with the data that is already trained, feed in the API call a set of values, and it will give me the predicted price. So we can actually use this programmatically. So that's what I did in my case. We go back to PHP 7. I've seen every single slide here referring to PHP prior to 7. I don't know what's going on with you people. PHP 7 is the stable version of PHP. You get a lot of performance improvements, so please switch to PHP 7, particularly with strict typing. So, yeah. So I'm just doing that. I'm going to utilize my API endpoint that Amazon created for my data with my training data to predict prices. It's very simple to use. There's a Composer package. Again, this code, I don't know if I'm going to publish the code. Yeah, I'm probably going to publish the code, but it's on the notes of the slide, so it's going to be available for you to figure out which Composer package and everything. But this is what I'm doing here, and just instantiating the Amazon API endpoint and just using it to predict my prices, where I'm telling the model ID, which is given to me by Amazon, the endpoint URL, which is given to me by Amazon, and then it just feed the values, and it will give me back the predicted price. So this is pretty cool. This is a way for us to actually avoid dealing with multi-dimension problems in TensorFlow. Now, what happens if the problem that I'm trying to solve is not a continuous correlation of values? What happens if instead of me trying to predict a house price, I'm trying to predict or I'm trying to classify information? What happens if instead of saying if a house has a certain price, I want to say if a house is overpriced or not? Or what happens if I'm trying to deal with spam? For example, in Workana, an open source a freelancing platform, there's a lot of communication between parties to actually, you know, work on jobs and work together. Believe it or not, there are people that actually use those tools to, you know, spam people or to actually do something that is not very nice and very proactive for our work. So we need to sort of figure out a way to say if an interaction between two parties could potentially be identified as spam, in my case, or another thing. So the weird thing is, again, the problem is that I can't use exactly the same model that I've been using before because I don't have a continuous problem here. It's not something that would be 0.348 spam. It's either spam or it isn't, that's it. So this sort of model wouldn't precisely work. But what I said at the very beginning is almost every single problem in TensorFlow would go back to the same code. So it's sort of, there's sort of a way to actually implement the same techniques that we did before, but solving this problem. Because again, I'm not gonna see a line of values. I would see either if message is spam, which is one, for example, I can say one is spam, zero is not spam, the next message is zero, then the next message is one, the next message is zero, so there's no line there. There's sort of an S-shaped function, which is a way for me to identify something is either zero or something is either one. Since again, this is a mathematical problem and there's no way for me to apply a linear regression problem to this kind of predicted or value that I want to predict it zero or one, I sort of apply a modification, which again, there's a whole mathematic concept behind it, which is called a sigmoid. You can look it up. But a sigmoid function, what it does is sort of takes my function into an S-shaped value. So in precisely this function, what it tells me is how probable it is for any given X value to be either zero or one. So it's as close as we can get to our model, to our problem. So again, I have my messages. I want to identify if something is either spam or not. I may also be interested in other classification problems. Not only if it's spam, I may be interested in something different. For example, when we launch, Workana, we were very interested to learn what our competitors did on our side, because we would find that every now and then our competitors would get into our site and actually use our platform to tell other people to go to their platform. So we started separating between spam and competitor spam. We wanted to learn if there was any sort of way, any sort of communication that our competitors were trying to take people away. So, great, I have a way for me to define a model that looks sort of like a sort of the same way that I did before, using the sigmoid function. How do I feed the data? What do I do? Do I give it messages? Of course not, because there's no numeric. What I can do is actually say, okay, I'm gonna take all the words or the most potential problematic words, put it and analyze which messages have those words and how many words or how many instances of that word is within each message. So that's what I'm doing here. I'm just taking three messages and I'm saying, okay, this message has two mentions of the word freed, and this other message has three versions of the word novello, which is, was our competitor, no longer there, but was the reason why we created this. And then you have, well, I don't know, maybe none of these messages mention the word bias, so we're fine. And we're trying to classify this each of these messages against one of these classifications or labels. It's either okay, spam or comp. Since, again, I need to train, I train on data that is actual real data. So I go and I feed a lot of messages where we know, because we analyze this data manually or through other mechanisms, that we know is either okay, spam or not. And I just simply say, okay, message number one, it's spam, but it's obviously, since it's spam, it's not neither okay nor competitor spam. It's just regular spam message. Then the next message is okay, no problem. The next message is comp. I'm doing this because I want to apply the same code that we did before for a very simple problem such as linear regression. So I'm creating actually what is called a one-hot vector. Again, these are all concepts that are going to come very handy in the next few minutes. So I do a hot vector and I say, okay, this message is either one thing or the other. And that's it. I start preparing the data. I prepare the data the same way that I would do others. In this case, I'm just taking a lot of text data and I'm creating what I need, a set of possible words that are problematic. And am I bad with time? Really? Yeah, I have a lot of slides. Do I go until 5:30 or 4 or 5? Really? Oh, jeez. Okay, I'm going to go really fast then. Okay, first time that I give it in the talk, I clarify it. Okay, so I can do this problem. I do the same sort of way where I define the function. In this case, again, I said that I needed a sigmoid, something that will modify the data. So fortunately, TensorFlow gives me that data. I'm going to go really fast now because I have 10 minutes and there's a lot of cool stuff. Silicon Valley, who knows this scene? They wanted to create a full identifying app and they did it wrong. So they only created an app that would identify if something was a hot dog or not. So that looks like something that we more, a problem that looks very complicated, right? Just taking an image and trying to identify what it is. Fortunately, an image is a set of pixels. If I put a set of pixels, this is, you know, a horizontal and vertical set of pixels with RGB values, the color that it has, if I put it one next to the other, I have a vector of values. And this is exactly what I need for TensorFlow to work. So I can use the same techniques. I can, you know, feed the data, train, analyze the cost, and whatnot. The cost here is going to be a little bit different because obviously the difference between color values doesn't make sense to tell us if something is a hot dog or not. If it's something is a little bit more or less reddish, it's not telling me if something is a hot dog or not. So there are ways to define it. But what happens if I don't want to do that? Because in order for a system such as that to work, I will have to have a, I don't know, 10 million photos of hot dogs for me to train on. That's not very, you know, practical. So I could go to Google, download all the images that are resulting of me searching hot dog, but that's also not practical. But fortunately, very recently, Google started launching all these amazing tools. That's why I really wanted to move fast, because those are the tools. One of those tools is entity identification in images, which is super awesome. This is something that is you can Google now, Google Vision API, and there's a little tool where you can upload files and it will tell you what it finds there. So in here, this is my beautiful city, Buenos Aires. Well, I don't live here anymore, but it's my country. And it identifies that it's probably a metropolitan area. He's right. It's metropolis, cityscape, skyline, city. It starts finding all these things that, as you know, are not problems that are very easy, that I could solve with the logic, the solutions that I've been having, because this is not something, a hot dog or no hot dog. This is identifying entities within one image. In order to do that, the problem becomes way more complex. We use neural networks, and this is where the very most important or more interesting problems are. I'm not going to explain this because I don't know it, but basically a neuron is a way for us to get data, do something with the data, and just send an output. Nothing that us programmers are surprised from, so it's very simple. An artificial neuron is something very similar to what we've seen so far, setting something that we will give a set of values on, weight those values to say how important, how less important that particular value is, apply some all those values to a bias. This is exactly what we've been doing so far. Apply a cost function, something that would make sense out of this data, and then create an output. That cost function is my key. It could be something that would simply tell me if there are lines in an image. It would be something that would tell me, grabbing something before, if there's, I don't know, a square in an image or a particular shape in an image. If I start layering these neurons, I start figuring out how Google does what they do. Because they can have layers that simply is about identifying lines, and the next layer will use that concept to say, okay, when the lines are united in this shape, then it sort of feels like a square. Then the next line, if it's a square that has this other stuff, then it's probably a building, and if it's probably a building, then some of the information that I want. Those are neural networks. It's the same concept that we've seen before, just layering it together. And this is a neural network in TensorFlow. It doesn't look any different than before. We just have a little bit more values, and we have an extra layer of a tensor function, where I define my hidden function, or my first layer, the layer that gets the data, and then another function that uses that layer to keep testing and training and working on this data. So the very basic concept that took us to a linear regression, we could apply to actually create neural network problems that are very, very cool to play with. In particular, in the Vision API that Google offers, they have really awesome stuff. They offer you text detection, which is figuring out what text is in an image. Yeah? Time? I don't care, I'm gonna keep going. They have face detection, if there is a face in the image. They have safe search detection. Again, who got the reference to Silicon Valley and hot dog or no hot dog? Do you know what ended up being? A porn an app that would actually analyze something was a penis or not a penis, so they will use that. So you can do that with safe search detection. It will tell you if something is violent, if something is adult, if something is whatever. Web detection is actually amazing. Web detection would not only tell you what sort of entity the image has, but it will give you information about that entity. So if you upload a picture of Mark Story, it will probably give you a link to Mark Story's Wikipedia page. You have a Wikipedia page? You're not that important? Okay, cool. So yeah, I ran it, and it would tell me there's a lot of, I did an example here, which is pretty cool. I just took my Twitters, my latest tweets. I grabbed the latest images, and I analyzed them to find what sort of entities I mentioned in my latest images. And my little tool that here tells me that I run it, and my little tool tells me that in my latest Twitters, I've been uploading things, screenshots, I don't know, driving, glasses, whatever. So this is something that I've used for Vision API. I'm not going to go through the code. This is PHP code that, again, is going to be available on the slides. What happens if instead of images, I want to analyze sentiment? I want to analyze if a text is actually positive or negative, if someone is upset or not, which was very important for us in Workanas, figuring out if a message is of someone being upset at a provider or not. So I can use another tool provided by Google, which analyzes the sentiment of a text, which is the natural language API. I use the natural language API here to get the latest CNN headlines from 2 days ago and analyze the sentiment. The highest the value, the most positive, the lowest, the more negative. Not surprisingly, most of CNN are negative. So that's the goal. Natural language API. Speech API is actually taking that a little bit further. And instead of me providing text, it's me providing audio. So we actually convert the audio to text and then told me analyze that text and give me, you know, how positive, how negative, and all those sort of things. I can actually give it war hints where I can say, okay, since this is a CakePHP conference, there's very likely that people would actually speak the word CakePHP. Then in our context would be hard to figure out. And this is very advanced. I've used it with a lot of videos, and it's very, very impressive how it works. So the awesome thing about all this is that someone stole this slide yesterday. I was really upset, but I didn't have time. Well, the awesome thing about all this is that we can combine all these little tools with what we can learn from TensorFlow and apply to make very complex solutions. In the Workana example where I mentioned messages coming in and forth, you can actually do logistic regression to analyze if something is spam or not. Then you can use OCR or the Google Vision API to actually look into attachments that people send to find if there is text, because people will actually use attachments to send, you know, to send contact information that we don't allow. We can use the natural language API to analyze sentiment to figure out if there's a potential problem where people are upset. And we can combine all of those to actually feed it to Amazon as different values, like we did with the house pricing, and it can predict if a project can actually be problematic or not based on all this other stuff. So yeah. I went super fast. I'm sorry about that. So I don't know if we're going to have time for questions, but I don't want to pass this through. I know a lot of people are helping in a lot of different causes, but I need to say this. This is a coworker and a friend. She's going through a treatment of multiple sclerosis, which is really, really crappy. And sadly, we live in a world where a lot of people think that the ability to survive is directly proportional to the salary that you make, which sucks. So she clearly had healthcare. It didn't cover her treatment, so she has to raise a lot of money not to have a really bad time with her family. So if you can spare whatever dollar that you have, please go to this page and send whatever you can. Or if you don't have anything to spare, just send messages of support. She would really, really appreciate it. So there are no questions. So sorry about that. First time that I gave this talk, there was a lot of content. But if there are questions about it, I'm available. I can show you the call. We can play to. We have? Oh, we have questions. OK, cool.
Anyone?
Oh. Here, I think.
Hmm? What am I doing?
That way.
That was a fact, yeah.
Okay. I would like to ask whether you use a solution in order to reduce the dimension of the data set or feature selection, because still, on the example that you mentioned with house prices, a lot of features might not be relevant to the
exactly.
price of the house mm-hmm. or be relevant, and we as people do not have the insight that it is.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. That's a good question. That's domain knowledge. That is, I mentioned that at the very beginning, where domain knowledge is very important. So when you have a problem such as, even when you think that our problem was very easy to figure out, it's not. Because I've introduced living area, lot size, and whatever. I haven't introduced, I don't know, geographical location versus a school, proximity to a good school, or other parameters that would define. For the most part, it's sort of a guessway. Again, everything in machine learning is actually sort of finding the best possible answer to your problem, but that doesn't mean that it's going to be perfect. So for the most part, you would take as many features as you can and try to analyze if that data against your test data, the data that you actually rely on and you know that this is, this house has this price or this message is spam, you will run it against there and see if actually the features that you selected have a good or a bad answer. If the features that I selected that I run against my test data create a problem with a cost that is too high, then probably I need to figure out other features. But it's always a problem of not guessing, but using TensorFlow or these other tools to figure it out. It's up to you. It's up to you, whatever it is that you do. This is very different. You know, if you are dealing with properties or if you're dealing with healthcare or whatever, each problem is completely different from the other. So there's no universal solution to figure out which features. You just have to make the best possible decision based on your domain knowledge. So that's the only answer that anyone can give you. Nobody can tell you, whatever problem you have, these are the features that you have to select. You have to figure it out based on your knowledge on the problem. That's all that you can do. But you can use these tools to actually, again, run a set of training against the features and then using other features and see how, high or lower the cost is. The set of features and data that produces the lowest cost is the best possible guess that you can take. Does that answer your question?
It was my question, sir. I think that actually the question was whether do you use an automation on that aspect, like backward feature elimination, something similar to that.
Something what?
Backward feature elimination. It's like an algorithm that actually tests.
Yeah, back propagation. Yeah. So yeah, you can use that, of course. But yeah, I mean, this is something that in our project we started only like figuring out and trying to play with it. We're not using it in an active project in our property pricing, because we are dealing with the actual, you know, someone guessed that these are the features, or someone created a formula based on all these features, and they figured that was the solution. So we're starting to introduce this, and that's one back propagation of features and all that, yeah.
Thank you.
My question was a little similar to the answer that you had said, but so if you're entering a domain that you just don't know, mm-hmm. Do you just throw all the possible features at it, or do you just run?
That's a great question. With everything in machine learning, particularly in this data, in deep learning, there is a lot of guessing again. Because if you throw all those dimensions, it may seem that you have a possible solution, but it may not be. The biggest asset that you have when you are trying this is not the amount of features, but mostly the amount of data that you provide. Because if you give it like a very small subset of data, then whatever solution that you got, or whatever regression model that actually works for you, may not work when you actually have very large volumes. So these sort of problems work better with the most volume of data. So yeah, initially, again, I would immediately try to identify as many features that I can, but if you can't figure out features, then yeah, you can, like you said, just take as many features and figure out if that produces something that makes sense against your test data. Okay. So again, that's, if you don't have test data, then you're basically fucked. But if you have test data, at least you have sort of a way to, you know, try to figure out if you're going on the right way or the wrong way.
No, that's fine, because the application that I have in mind, I'm just going to collect as much information as possible for every user. The other question that I had was pertaining to being able to identify maybe new features. Like, is there a way for you to say, okay, these are all the different variables for, so in my mind, I'm thinking user choices. So I'm thinking, is there a system where I would just throw all possible features and maybe the system can then identify like certain patterns, like for example, every bathroom that is of this size pertaining to a lot of this particular size has a higher value, something like that, something crazy like that. Yeah. Are there systems out there for that?
Not that I know, but you know, could be. Most of the tools that I've shown were literally introduced in the last 6 months. So,
oh, wow.
I mean, this could change tomorrow. Tomorrow maybe something there to make a little bit. That would be a hard problem because if you find a way for a system to tell you which are the features that you need to select, I mean, what are we doing? We don't need to work. Like the system is doing everything.
I was thinking more like for your spam example, right?
Yeah.
You give it a whole bunch of messages.
The words. Yeah, that's
right.
A perfect.
Can it identify words as these are competitor words and these are spam words?
That's but you don't know. That's a great question. So, in the message example, I selected a subset of words because I needed to create a matrix. You know, something that I could control and that all messages would comply to. It wouldn't make sense for me to do matrix operations where a message has 10 words and the next message has 20. I can't. So I sort of needed to normalize that data and figure a way for me to fit as many words or as low words as I wanted to. But yeah, I mean, that would be a very interesting problem to solve. I think someone will hire you immediately if you solve that problem.
Cool, great. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I'm sorry about the time.